Are you online? Buenos días. Continuando con el programa, a nombre del señor embajador de la UNESCO, Jorge Herrera Ramos, y presidente de la World Congress, the World of Neurosurgery on Your Fingertips, y a quien agradecemos por la organización de este magno evento, así como a la doctora Deyanira Capi, presidenta del capítulo de la ANS en el Instituto Politécnico Nacional, al doctor Salim Abdulrauf, presidente de la Walter E. Dandy Neurosurgical Society, al doctor Babak Kateb, presidente de la Society of Brain Mapping and Therapeutics and the Brain Mapping Foundation, todos ellos vicepresidentes del comité organizador, y al doctor Parménides Guadarrama Ortiz, quien es director del Centro Especializado en Neurocirugía y Neurociencias México. Es para mí un honor presentar al doctor Mustafa Abascaya, quien es profesor de neurocirugía en la Escuela de Medicina y Salud Pública de la Universidad de Wisconsin, director de Laboratorio y Habilidades en Base de Cráneo y Microcirugía, y el director del Fellowship en Cirugía Cerebrovascular y Base de Cráneo en la Universidad de Wisconsin-Madison. Sus especialidades incluyen cirugía de tumores de base de cráneo, cirugía cerebrovascular y tumores cerebrales y espinales complejos en regiones de alta funcionalidad. Hoy nos deleitará con la ponencia titulada ¿Is Neurosurgery Rocket Science? ¿Por qué se está repitiendo?
Thank you, Dr. Andrea. My name is Natalia Fedor. Dr. Andrea, did you finish? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Andrea. My name is Natalia Fedorchenko, and I'm representing the organizing committee of the World Congress of Neuroscience, the World of Neurosurgery at Your Fingertips. We are welcoming all of you today, and thank you for joining us. I would like to say thank you to the chairman of the Congress, Ambassador of UNESCO Associated School Network, Mr. Jorge Herrera, for the idea of organizing this Congress and really great organization. Thank you for the cooperation, Voltidendron Neurosurgical Society, particularly Dr. Salim Abdulrauf, and the Foundation for Brain Mapping and Dr. Babak Kateb, as well as thank you to the WAPS Medical Student Chapter in Mexico and Neurosurgical TV for their broadcasting. And today I would like to present to you our first speaker, Dr. Mustafa Abascaya. He is a tenured professor and the Robert Dempsey Professor of Neurological Surgery at the University of Wisconsin School of Medicine and Public Health, director of the skull-based surgery program, the Lincoln Ramirez Neuroanatomy Microsurgery Skills Laboratory, and the fellows program in cerebrovascular skull-based surgery, all at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. His clinical specialties include surgeries of skull-based tumors, cerebrovascular surgery, and complex tumors, deep and highly functional regions of the brain and spinal cord. So, Dr. Mustafa Abascaya, we would like to listen to you.
Thank you very much, Natalia, Andre, for a nice introduction. And I'd like to thank Jorge, Dr. Jorge Herrera, and the rest of the organizer for hosting me today. It's a great pleasure to be here. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you are. So I'm going to share my screen now. It says host disabled participants screen sharing.
Dr. Andrea, could you please allow the screen sharing?
You can already share your screen, doctor.
Okay, can you guys see okay?
Yeah, all is good.
Okay, so I have many videos and I hope you guys enjoy. And I'm, like I said before, I'm notorious to exit my time. So just warn me if it's too much.
No problem, not too much.
Today is, I have no disclosures, and this is our lovely city, Madison, and capital city of the state of Wisconsin. It's very nice in the spring and the summer. Winters are long and can be hard, but we love this city. So is neurosurgery rocket science, right? That's the thing. So there's this analogy between neurosurgeons and rocket scientists. I thought might be a good idea to present my talk in that way. And is the neurosurgery really, really complex discipline? It is really hard to perform, or it's in reality, we are making it hard and find the difficulties and present those difficulties and not find a simple way of dealing with the daily neurosurgical cases. So if you think like I'm going to present you to, I found this molecule cures the brain cancer, glioblastoma. I've done like a thousand experiments and I have found the cure for the meningioma. I'm not going to talk about that. And I don't think we will find the cure for GBM or meningioma in the next 50 years. So how can we simply treat, help these patients with these complex cranial pathologies? That's what I'm going to talk about today. So the way I know and make the neurosurgery not rocket science, but a simple science, simple clinical practice is the anatomy. And anatomy starts with the Galen, goes to the Vesalius, Retius, beautiful subarachnoid space description in this book. And then Yashargi rejuvenates the cisternal subarachnoid space approach. And that's all you need to know about neurosurgery. And we neurosurgeons, unfortunately, don't know neuroanatomy. And when we are faced to do this complex cranial pathologies, deep-seated, eloquent cortex, we always think, oh, this is very difficult, this is complex, cannot be done, this is inoperable. Is it really? So I'll give you two examples, how neurosurgeons' conception make these two cases so complex and resulted in a negative way. So this is a one-year-old patient presents with the complex partial seizures, okay? Where is this located? It's in the mesial temporal lobe and high in the amygdala. So how we approach this and conventional way, if you think the neurosurgery rocket science, it is conventional way you go through the cortex, right? This is temporal neocortex and you disconnect the temporal neocortex from the older cortex, which is the mesial temporal side. And yes, maybe you cure the lesion, but this disconnection of the neocortex in 1 year old, this patient may be cured, but he's not going to be a nurse, engineer, or doctor, or neurosurgeon. Because this non-dominant temporal cortex is important in many visuospatial high cognitive functions. On the contrary, this neurosurgeon takes the correct approach. Yes, this is again almost similar location. And instead of going transcortical, he comes transsylvian, perfect. He doesn't go through any normal cortex, but he gets into the gyrus rectus. So this is the right surgical approach, but the wrong localization, okay? Because we don't know neuroanatomy. So then how are we going to approach this? We'll start with the limbic. If we start with the limbic lobe, limbic system, how are we going to approach these mesial temporal and ventricular trigonal lesions? So anatomical considerations, yes, 100%. Pathological anatomy, which is disturbed anatomy by the pathology, yes, we need to consider that too. Pathology changes the normal anatomy and I call it disturbed anatomy or pathological anatomy. Personal preferences, we shouldn't have any personal preferences. If we train in only doing the transcortical way, we should go learn neuroanatomy and learn other techniques to do better. Not make neurosurgery rocket science, make neurosurgery simple science. Okay, so that's why we shouldn't consider any personal preferences. Okay, so what is inoperable? We hear this word, right? Inoperable, inoperable, inoperable. This is inoperable. Inoperable. English is not my first language, so I look at the Webster dictionary. This is exactly what it says: unable to remove by operation. What are the factors when we call the tumors inoperable in the brain? Location, if it is located in the eloquent cortex, if it is very deep, accessing it's going to cause more problems. Or surgeon related. Surgeon doesn't know how to get there or doesn't have experience. Or disease is so diffuse, removing it, part of the disease or problem is not going to help the patient at all. Or disease is very advanced. So, and how do we define the eloquent cortex? If we remove eloquent cortex, that will result in loss of cognitive functions, motor functions, linguistic functions, or any other functions like lower cranial nerve functions, cranial nerve functions. So, first I'm gonna talk about the gliomas. Okay, I'm gonna show you cases, glioma cases, then vascular cases, and I'm gonna group to the vascular aneurysms, revascularization, AVMs. So, if we exit the time too much, we can stop, and maybe some other time I can specifically talk about specific topics like vascular AVMs or bypass. So how do we treat the gliomas nowadays, right? That's my clinical practice. I do 1/3 skull base, 1/3 open vascular, 1/3 difficult gliomas. So glioma surgery, transcranial surgery, intrinsic tumors, stereotactic tumor biopsy, or laser ablation, right? These are the things we use. And there are so many different radiation modalities, chemotherapy options, targeted therapies, and this is the new thing. And we do everything to keep these patients alive and give them a good time, good functional outcome. So what is the goal of the glioma surgery? It is the gross total resection. If it is not enhancing, contrast enhancing, removing the T2 flare changes. If it is enhancing, removing the enhancing part and maybe removing the non-enhancing part, T2 flare changes, which might be diffuse tumor, not enhancing, or edema, we don't know. And when you are doing that, this procedure, surgery, should result in no neurological deficits or minimal neurological deficits. What do we have adjuncts to help this, to increase the extent of resection and increase the safety of the surgery and giving the patient the best chance? And as a surgeon, yes, you know neuroanatomy. You must develop the skills to operate on these, but you have to have some adjuncts, right? What do we have? We have functional MRI. We can map the motor area, speech area, etc. We have diffusion tensor imaging. We can see the fibers. They are involved by the tumor or not. And we can do angiography to test the dominant site for speech or memory if necessary. Intraoperatively, we can do awake craniotomy, right? If you are there, your patient's awake, you cause any problem, you stop surgery. We can do motor speech mapping. We can do cortical, subcortical stimulation. Nowadays, every place on the earth has the frameless neuronavigation. Intraoperative MRI, yes, I have it. MEPs, SCCP monitoring, cranial nerve monitoring, yes, we have it. Microscope-aided adjuncts like fluorescein, 5-ALA, yes, we have it. But are they really helpful? So these are the three cases I use, either adjuncts or I didn't use the adjuncts, okay? So three examples: large grade 3 anaplastic astrocytoma. It's close to the speech area, close to the motor area. Yes, I did the awake craniotomy. Yes, I used the intraoperative MRI. And this is the intraoperative MRI imaging. I resected the tumor and I stopped at point that I'm satisfied with the resection. And we are in the intraoperative MRI suite, put the patient in the scanner, looks nice, wonderful, stop. You left the tumor, you think you can resect, go back and clean. Very nice adjunct, right? And this one is different. This is the tumor involving the single edge gyrus extending into the corpus callosum. It's quite anterior. I don't need any adjuncts. This is the region we can go interhemispherically, okay, like this, and perform gross total, even in some cases, supratotal resection. And this patient, GBM, grade 4 astrocytoma, survived 6 years. He may have survived 6 months, but I give him the best chance to beat the odds, okay? That's all about the neurosurgery. Neurosurgery is simple, but we are making it complex. And this is another one, grade 3 oligodendroglioma, very aggressive tumor. This is nothing to do with the motor, nothing to do with the speech. It's away from the inferior frontal gyrus. So, okay, gross total resection, grade 3, survived so many years. Yes, receive radiation. Yes, receive Temodar. But surgery and radiation together makes the big difference. Eloquent and deep brain regions, what are they, right? Cortical areas, motor, speech, visual, cognitive functions. I just show you that. And these are, yes, you may need to use the awake craniotomy mapping, and you know the anatomy. Exposure is not a problem in many of these cases, but exposure, accessing, approaching them is a problem in these locations, right? I just show you one cingulate tumor, and I'm gonna show you again. So this another one, posterior cingulate tumor. It seems like crossing the other side, but actually this is expansion of the cingulate gyrus. And if you look at carefully, this is right under the motor cortex. So getting there is an issue. It is not involving the motor cortex. It's pushing the motor cortex. So you go interhemispheric fissure. Use the natural corridors as introduced by Yashar Gil, right? That's what we did. And he's been doing fine. See, this is the motor area, but this is the tumor location. And without touching the motor, you can remove this tumor. And next area is the mesial temporal lobe. What is the mesial temporal or mediobasal temporal region? It starts from the uncus, it goes all the way to lingual gyrus and isthmus, and maybe little portion of the cingulate gyrus. So, and we like to divide into three. You can divide any way you like to. And anterior location, for example, this is anterior location, is perfect like that 1 year old. This is dominant side. If you come here, you're gonna injure the visual pathway, right? Or you are risking to injure the speech too. Is you're gonna retract, you're gonna go through the cortex. And plus going through the normal cortex, if you can, you should avoid normally. So this is the perfect case for the Transylvian. And this is just to show you the exposure. I'm not gonna take your time with the whole thing. Wide opening of the Sylvian fissure as you do selective Transylvian selective amygdala hippocampectomy, opening the thing and mobilizing the temporal polar artery away and making the cortical incision, small incision in the Lehmann insula and going into the ventricle. So I minimize the transecting, transgressing through the cortex. And you find the tumor in the inferior horn, you remove the tumor. So good results, gross total resection. I did my best to give the patient the best chance. Another lesion is in the fusiform gyrus. See, it is parahippocampal gyrus is preserved. And this is it right in the middle. If it was this big, I can come Transylvian. If it is this big, I can come posteriorly. So the best way in this case, in my opinion, a subtemporal approach. Yes, we don't like subtemporal approach because you need a lot of retraction, but you can use brain relaxation techniques. And this is the perfect case. And you don't go, you just remove the tumor. Okay, you don't go through any brain. And result is good. And we achieved the gross total resection, grade 3 anaplastic astrocytoma. This patient survived many, many years. What about this one? Now we are in the posterior one third, right? This is, if I come here, I need to go through this much normal cortex. If I come subtemporal, it's kind of posterior, vein of Labbe is there, elevation of the posterior temporal lobe, dominant lobe can make us contusions. So this is the perfect case for the supracerebellar transtentorial approach. That's how we do. So this is the tentorium, this is cerebellum. You cut the tentorium, you are looking at the mesiotemporal structures, okay? I'm gonna skip this and we just remove the pathology. You see, no transcortical approach, no contusion, just over the cerebellum. Very simple approach, every day's approach, like where you are doing like a chiare, you just extend the incision a little longer, do the craniotomy a little higher, cross the transverse sinus so you can retract the tentorium and you have perfect approach, okay? So that's the way. This is the only way. I'm not saying this is the only way, but this is the way, okay? So, and how do we do this? Yaşargil introduced this in 1986. You can cross, you can do different modification, midline, eccentric to one side, or only paramedian, depends on the location and of the tumor. And you need to cross the sinus so you can retract and then cut the tentorium. This is the cerebellum. And you, if you do this in sitting position, you don't even need a retraction. Even in the prone position, rarely use retraction. You just gently depress with your suction, cut the tentorium, you are looking at this region. And if tumor is located here, you remove it here, 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 wherever, okay? You just posterior one third of the medial basal temporal region. And we describe many, many other aspects of this, but original description by Professor Yaşargil and many other neurosurgeon, including Dr. Evandro de Oliveira from Brazil and Dr. Uğur Türe from Turkey, they have also extensive experience with this approach. And what about this? This is a gigantic tumor, 11 centimeter tumor, 37-year-old patient, very active, working, and in over 6 months, he becomes incapacitated, cannot see, peripheral visual loss, memory loss, speech problems, and how are we gonna do this? They call it inoperable. This is too large. It involves many, many region. Actually, it starts from all the way from uncus and involves entire limbic system. And then goes through this isthmus and goes through the posterior cingulate. So in my opinion, if you take one approach, it's not gonna be enough. So you need to stage, and I like to stage these surgeries. How I did it, in first stage, I come transsylvian pretemporal and get the anterior part of it. Second stage, I come supracerebellar transtentorial, get the part going to the brainstem. So this pushing the cerebellum and the brainstem and get these parts. But coming through here, I couldn't reach the part of the tumor going through the posterior cingulate gyrus. So then I give a couple of weeks, came back, occipital interhemispheric. So three stages, three surgeries. It sounds crazy, right? Too much, three surgeries. Why? No, it is not. So 7 years, he has been living normal now, working, normal family life, okay? We remove the tumor. We didn't remove the brain. What about insula, right? Insula, island of the rail. 76-year-old man, professor of engineering, very active, still working, and starts becoming a little weak in the face and the hand, and maybe seizure activity questionable. And what are we gonna do? What they say? We do stereotactic biopsy, you're gonna be weak, you're gonna be paralyzed, you're gonna be having all these problems, have a radiation, biopsy, radiation, and maybe temodar, and then, you know, take your chance, maybe you survive 6 months, 9 months. So this is the best way. No, insula, it's not very extensive tumor. Yes, it's grade 4, but we can remove this without very, very traumatic surgery, right? This is the way Yaşar Gil described, trans-sylvian approach. If neocortex is not involved, you go to the sylvian fissure. And I see the people doing the mapping on the dominant side, going through the cortex here, cortex here. Why you remove normal cortex? Why you make, you do all these mappings? You don't need to map. I'm not removing those regions. You don't need to. It's a big thing. I do awake craniotomy, insert tumor surgery. If it is not, neocortex is not involved, no need to remove any normal tissue, okay? And this is how we do trans-sylvian approach. And going through the sylvian fissure, opening the sylvian fissure widely all the way from anterior, from all the way from M1 to the M2s when they become M3, from both operculi, temporal, frontal, parietal, everything is exposed, and you devascularize the tumor the way described by Yaşar Gil, right? You take the M2 feeders, they are going to normal insula, but now insula is the tumor. You are taking them and preserving the lenticular street arteries. You can watch some other insular tumor surgeries by us and in operative neurosurgery, neurosurgical focus, but this is different patients. I'm defining the first normal anatomy, okay, MCA, okay? I'm defining M2s and skeletonizing them and take only the branches going to the insula, okay? And mobilizing, preserving the veins, preserving the normal arteries, and see, this is the tumor. Now I'm going to take these tiny, tiny M2 feeders going to insula, now it's tumor, and devascularize the tumor, then eventually remove tumor, okay? Yes, do I use MEPs? Yes, I want to know how it is. It increases your confidence, yes. I use subcortical stimulation to avoid the entrance to the internal capsule corona radiata, yes. But see, I am taking those feeders now. Everything is exposed. Small feeders going. And I use adjuncts. But adjuncts, subcortical stimulation, MEPs, they are not doing the surgery. I am doing the surgery. See, one by one. And these small arteries, maybe 50, maybe 60, maybe 70 small arteries you take in it during these surgeries, okay? And skeletonize them one by one, M2 branches, and then start debulking, and if necessary, do more, okay? Now I'm devascularizing the tumor surface and keep devascularizing the feeders. Now I'm entering the tumor, okay, as much as you can. And then once you debulk the tumor, you deflate the tumor, and then you see more branches coming, then you take them. And going through the circular sulcus, frontal side, temporal side, and meet at one point, and avoiding injury to the anterior perforated substance, arteries, lenticular stress arteries going to the anterior perforated substance. See, I debulk and I start mobilizing the tumor more, and I'm going. So now I define the margins, right? This is the normal brain. This is the pathological brain. This is the tumor. Low setting of the ultrasonic aspirator, not more than 10. So you don't injure these tiny branches, and see, I'm very close to the arteries, but low intensity, and tumor is soft, it's coming, and I see the pathological tissue and the normal tissue. And part of the tumor stuck to the thing, and then I'm gonna coagulate that and cut, and progress, keep moving until you get this gross total resection. And you see these arteries now is almost like a cadaveric dissection. All the arteries, candelabra is all around. Principles, okay? Dissection, and then moving along the circular sulcus, and almost like you are doing the anatomical dissection, fiber dissection, okay? Now you see tissue start becoming, I'm using subcortical stimulation, yes. I'm staying away, keep going. If you're away, keep going. And it's, most of these tumors don't infiltrate the coronal radiata, okay, or internal capsule, they push. So first structure you will get the basal ganglia. And you can, if you know the anatomy, you can distinguish basal ganglia has a special brown color with the nutmeg appearance, white dots. And then you know that, you identify that, you are staying away from the internal capsule, okay? And I don't wanna take too much time. And then, so you finish. At the end, it looks all around, you are looking at normal brain, okay? And this is the way, okay? Normal cortex. Pre-op, post-op, Gross total resection, including the T2 flare changes around the enhancing part. And he's back to school, okay? He's still teaching and he's very active, cognitively perfect. We see radiation, everything, and doing very well, more than a year now. Another one, okay? The 21st century United States, this patient gets seizures, goes to the status, they call this limbic encephalitis, treated her two courses of acyclovir, okay? And things doesn't get better. Oh, I'm sorry, this is a different patient. I'm sorry, these slides are mixed. This is a young man, again, in gigantic 7 centimeter insular tumor. Same principle, we move tumor, we don't move the brain, okay? And it's mixed. That's the first patient, limbic encephalitis, they thought, treated, MRIs in December, MRIs in March. You see tumor is growing. And what they do all kind of workup. She's not responding. She's on many seizure medications. Tumor is growing. They go here and biopsy. And it's biopsy itself is not conclusive. They just got some tissue, maybe grade 2, maybe grade 3, maybe grade 4, enough tissue. And they tell her to go have radiation, okay? As tumor is growing. This is an insular tumor with the medial basal extension, okay? So what we do? Surgery. They call this inoperable. They call it inoperable because they don't know anatomy. It's dominant lobe, but I'm not gonna touch the speech. I'm gonna go through the Sylvian fissure, natural corridor created. It's for you, for neurosurgeons. Why you make it so complex? Okay, go, same thing. Sylvian fissure opening, okay, is gonna be a little more tougher because she apparently had a biopsy and that biopsy caused some kind of scarring here, see? And made it the surgery more difficult. So that's, they also inject the some kind of hemostatic material. God, computer is not cooperating today. So same principle. And this time I'm gonna go more because extension goes towards the mesial temporal lobe. I'm gonna go through the same way through this Lehmann insula, go take that part too. See, I'm skeletonizing all these arteries, it's very stuck, but you develop these skills. This can be done. I didn't invent these techniques, okay? And many, many neurosurgeons can do this. If I can do it, you can do it too, okay? If somebody can run the 100 meters less than 10 seconds, many people can run, right? It just needs training, learning, and then doing it over and over again, see? This is done. We'll go remove everything like the first case. Now we are limbic lobe. I'm sorry, a mesial temporal region. And we're gonna do that. This is the result. So if this was inoperable, how did I do surgery? So it wasn't inoperable. This was operable tumor. Neurosurgeon thought it's inoperable. It's wrong. Anatomy. If you are doing surgery anywhere, neuroanatomy is the main thing, okay? You need to know the variations of the veins. You need to know the variations of the arteries. You need to know the gyral anatomy, sulcal anatomy is like your hand, okay? That's the only way. And if you don't know it, this is what happens. This is my surgery, okay? Transylvian approach, all operculi preserved, see? Skeletonized everything. This is somebody else did that cortical stimulation and the dominant lobe, okay? This is the sylvian fissure. They didn't touch the sylvian fissure. They went to the temporal operculum, frontal operculum, map. Look at this brain. Look at this. Ugly, right? Why you need to do that? Don't do it. It's only good way. Transylvian, okay? Don't listen to those, I do the awake craniotomy. You do 6 hours awake craniotomy, patient cannot even speak. You stay 6 hours in the operating room, under those drapes, cold, give you the sedations. Speak, how are you gonna speak? 30-year-old, okay? Very large tumor, okay? They explore this tumor at the outside hospital. And they remove part of it, and the neurosurgeon gets nervous about it and then stops and sends patient to us rightfully. So very good approach. He thought he could remove it, and he had difficulties during surgery, and he stopped it. Nothing wrong with that. Okay, and sent to patient somebody who can do it. This is his previous incision. Okay, we're gonna go. We're gonna extend the craniotomy. Okay, craniotomy was kind of small. We're gonna open their surgery. This is the hemostatic agent they put. Okay, we're gonna remove all those first. And we're gonna try to get the, and then questionable area, infection or not, but it turned out to be not infectious. And all the surgery cells, hematoma, we're gonna remove. So now I'm trying to get, then once I clean those, I'm gonna do Transylvian approach, right? And remove the insular portion of the tumor, and then go to the frontobasal region and follow the tumor into the basal ganglia and then the in the lateral ventricle, okay? Are we doing okay? Are you guys enjoying? Okay, so okay, this is the insular portion. We are getting our own samples. Okay, removing the insular portion of the tumor, MCA branches, and the residual tumor, temporal operculum is preserved. This tumor was coming from this way and pushing the temporal operculum, giving the impression that temporal operculum was invaded by the tumor, and actually it was compression. So we remove that part of the exophytic tumor. Then we go. Okay, now we are getting to the normal anatomy, okay? So now we're gonna take all these frontal base, and we're gonna go into the basal, first frontal, basal frontal lobe. See, we're gonna see the ACA, anterior cerebral artery. We're gonna see the olfactory tract, and see your olfactory tract is there. We're gonna try to preserve that. MCA, ACA, ICA. See, that's the olfactory tract. It's actually, it's not optic nerve, this is olfactory tract. Okay, Now you're seeing the optic nerve, chiasm. Okay, you're gonna take all these. All this is a pathological tissue, nothing normal, okay? Okay. Now we are taking the part of the tumor going into the lateral ventricle. I'm gonna speed up. See, this is the part going into the lateral ventricle. And this is 30-year-old patient, okay? You cannot let this patient go easily. Okay, we'll go. And once we go to the ventricle, we go into the contralateral ventricle. And as you see now, I'm doing the hemostasis. You see the tumor is involving entire basal region. So it's, see here, you have to go all, remove these, okay? Immediate post-op. Follow-up MRI. These are all surgical trauma, but there's no tumor, I guarantee you. Okay. Did I do anything different? Any removing a small tumor or this is same principles. Okay. Follow the anatomy, follow the pathological anatomy. Thalamus, another region that's very difficult to understand for neurosurgeons, and standard treatment is usually biopsy and radiation in glioma of the thalamus, but unilateral thalamic tumors, actually gliomas, can be removed safely. If not gross totally, near totally. This is a 6-year-old boy called inoperable by many centers. They put the shunt and send him to the radiation. But family reached out to me and we did the surgery. Same principle. In this one, I went transcortical and I used the transsulcal approach. I retracted sulcus so with the tenor suture, so I don't have to do full retraction and then don't contuse the brain and going through the sulcus. Okay. And same thing, gross total resection. Yes, I went through the cortex, but I thought in this case that's the better way, and it worked out well. If you can, you should avoid going to the cortex, but in anterior thalamic tumors, I'll go interhemispheric transcalosal. You can do posterior interhemispheric approaches. So there are too many ways of doing it, but just do your best, okay, for that patient, okay? Same, it seems like bithalamic tumor, but in reality, this is an expansion of the unilateral thalamic tumor. They recommended biopsy in many centers. We did the occipital interhemispheric subcallosal approach and got to the tumor, removed the tumor. And this is something they called inoperable and told her she'll be paralyzed and in coma if somebody did the surgery. She believed me. And see this immediate MRI, post-op MRI. And 41 months, she finished the college. She traveled, she did everything she wants to do. She survived 4 years. Okay. So this was inoperable tumor, right? Brainstem, same story. Focal brainstem lesions, you can operate. There are different ways of getting there, okay? This is a mesencephalic tumor, as a posterior, a part of the mesencephalon. And we can go transcollicular, described by Yonekawa, successor of Yashar Gill. And I did the same thing. And normal visual, normal eye motions, nothing unusual. Went home postoperative day 4, grade 3 anaplastic astrocytoma, gross total resection. Another very recent case, medulla oblongata, 60-year-old, very severe nausea, vomiting, intractable, and we removed it. She went home day two, no deficits, her nausea, vomiting got much better, improved completely now. It's great for astrocytoma. I gave her the best chance to beat the odds, okay? What about skull-based tumors, right? Skull-based tumors will operate, most of them, but we'll do, we'll neurosurgeons again make it so complex, they will say, ah, this is artery was going in, sorry, I couldn't remove, I didn't even attempt to remove because if I do it, I will hurt the patient. We need to learn from our failures too, correct, but if we fail all the time, why are we doing this, right? So this is it. Anterior clinoidal meningioma, one eye only light perception, and then you look at this, this is crossing, and they told her, you already lost the vision in one eye, and don't worry, you are 75-year-old, go live your life, no surgery, no radiation, nothing. But what happens if in a few years this gets the other eye? And she's very active, very healthy, she's working. So I said, at least we can try to remove and decompress the chiasm so you don't have to worry about visual loss in the future on the other eye. And if I can try, I can remove maybe all of it, okay? So this is the tumor involving the, and I like to do extradural anterior clinoidectomy in this case. You see the optic nerve here, optic unroofing was performed, clinoidal segment of the ICA, get the proximal control. We're gonna open the dura and go to intradural. See, proximal M1, ICA, OA1 is all encased by the tumor. So if tumor is not invading the adventitia, you can remove it, okay? In some clinoidal meningiomas, it's true. It invades the adventitia, then you don't wanna remove that part of the tumor. But you can remove most of it, okay? So this is the I call it ultra microsurgery because I'm gonna skeletonize this and one by one using the sharp dissection and see I'm dividing the tumor. I find the oculomotor nerve and I keep dissecting, eventually get to the thing. See, this is the area now I am testing is adventitia involved or not. Once I get the sense that not, I'm doing, see, this is the A1. This is the A1. I'm gonna dissect the A1. I have to respect the A1 and A1 perforators, right? And go dissect. You see the A1 perforator here, 1, 2. And now I got that part of the tumor. I'm changing my plan. I divide, dissect. So just heavily involved in this location, but I was able to peel it. PCOM, okay. Now this is the calcified part. I'm coming to the clinoid and the optic roof is already drilled, okay. I have a proximal control. I can open this distal dural ring and I get the control right away, but I'm okay now. You see the pituitary stalk. Extreme importance of preserving these superior hypophyseal perforators going to the chiasm, see? They are long, they are stretched by the tumor, but not invaded by the tumor, okay? So you see all these are superior hypophyseal arteries. They go to the chiasm and you have to preserve them. And now you see the choroidal artery, anterior choroidal artery, A1 perforators, there's still tumor. But I think we are winning the game here. You see the contralateral optic nerve and final piece of the tumor, intradural component. And then I'm gonna cut the distal dural ring, anterior clinoidal dura to establish the Simpson grade one resection, okay? And if I couldn't, I could have left a small piece, but at least I try my best, right? And believe or not, this that eye, only light perception, she start counting fingers in 3 months. didn't improve more than that, but at least she could see, and at least we preserved the chiasm and other side. Okay, and she's working, very happy. So extradural clinoidectomy, intradural clinoidectomy, whichever way you want to do it, is very important part of the surgeries in this location anterior skull base. You should go to the lab, practice, and learn this anatomy and how to do it. And these are the videos taken in our lab, practicing the extradural clinoidectomy and the dissection of this dura extradurally, peeling the dura propria from the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. So you can do safe clinoidectomy. You see the clinoid here. And then another case, we use the anterior clinoidectomy, trigeminal schwannomas. You don't need to do combine many stage surgeries in this one. If you come here, transcavernous, most of the trigeminal schwannomas already made the Petros apicectomy, Kawase approach. So using that or extending a little more, you can get the infratentorial part of the posterior fossa component of the tumor as well. This is how we do it. And it's, I'm gonna skip this. And gross total resection in 72-year-old trigeminal schwannoma is cured, okay? How do we do it? Depends on the location of the trigeminal schwannoma and where it is coming from. If it is in the root, you come retrosigmoid. If it is in the gastrocnemius ganglion, you can come anterior, okay? If it is purely infratemporal fossa, you go do the temporal approaches or zygomatic approaches or intraorbital or combination. Sometimes we have gigantic, and this is not a trigeminal schwannoma, it's a chondrosarcoma, but imagine that this was a gigantic trigeminal schwannoma. You can use the same approach. One carotid artery is gone in this patient, is gigantic. They do biopsy. They say, this is inoperable. Go have a proton beam therapy because this is chondrosarcoma grade 2. We can remove this. And if you remove the chondrosarcomas gross totally, then do the proton beam, 5 years survival is 80%. Okay? So you are giving, there's a chance you may even cure these diseases. So how we do it? We do it this way, frontotemporal approach, extradural peeling of the dura. Okay, clinoidectomy. And I'm gonna keep moving. Okay, this is the way described by Dolench and now rejuvenated by Ali Krisht. You know, this is cavernous sinus. You can operate. This is not no man's land anymore, okay? In selected cases, you can do very, very successful surgery and you see the anatomical dissections exactly the way. Middle meningeal artery, I'm finding the GSPN. From geniculate ganglion, go this way. See, that's the stimulation of the geniculate ganglion and identifying the GSPN. I'm gonna cut first drill over the foramen spinosum, foramen ovale, and then cut the middle meningeal artery, keep mobilizing until I get to the tumor, okay? And this is, you see the tumor is expanding whole wall. Okay, see, this is the temple dura. I'm peeling, and purely extradural now. We're gonna go intradural, but if this tumor didn't have a intradural component, you can perform this surgery completely extradural. Okay, you don't even see the brain. Okay, we go remove. So you see the branches. And now I'm gonna cut tentorium, membrane, and then they go between tumors. Then I'm gonna cut tentorium and superior petrosal sinus, remove all the tumor with the dura, with the drill from the bone, going into the clivus. Now I'm cutting the superior petrosal sinus, which is occluded by the tumor, so it's not bleeding. Cisternal root of the trigeminal nerve, see, this is the cisternal segment. Now I am in the posterior fossa, okay? So I'm gonna remove the part of the tumor from the posterior fossa. Okay, make sure you are not pulling the brainstem when you are doing this, okay? And And then I'm going to put the endoscope, review the anatomy, any remnants we can remove and achieve the gross total resection, okay? We put the fat, normal. Just brief review of this anatomy here, okay? This is the cadaveric specimen. We remove the brain to facilitate the easy dissection. You see the cranial nerve 3 entering the cavernous sinus, cranial nerve 4, V1, V2, V3. This is the way you do it, okay? You peel the dura from the wall of the cavernous sinus, okay? And then you expose all these regions. If there's a tumor, you can remove. Now you see the GSPN coming from geniculate ganglion, middle meningeal artery. What I did, I drilled the bone here. I mobilized these. Petrous apex was eaten by the tumor already. I didn't need to do any petrous apexectomy. And this is the Kawase, triangle or quadrangle, okay? Superior petrous sinus is very visible. All the cavernous sinus triangles, Parkinson, etc. You can study, learn, and then you use those. See, this is the approach. Okay. So sometimes you take more than one approach. Okay. This is the case: 60-year-old man, female with this tumor. I thought I will first address the, because she was very symptomatic from the ataxia, and I wasn't sure what kind of tumor this is. Is it trigeminal schwannoma, meningioma, what? And I did the first retrosigmoid craniotomy, and pathology turned out to be grade 2 meningioma, okay? So atypical meningioma. So I came back and removed the rest with the transcavernous approach. Same principle, you're going through. See here, opening, and this is the tumor, is elastic fibrotic type of tumor. And we're gonna get into the tumor and decompress. And you need to know your anatomy here and working between trigeminal nerve root 2 and the 3, not, I'm sorry, branches V2 and V3. And now I'm gonna work between V1 and V2. And mobilize that, pay attention to the carotid, okay? And don't use high intensity ultrasonic aspirators near the arteries or the nerves, okay? Removing piece by piece, mobilizing. Now I got the CSF, that means I am the cisternal in the Gasserian ganglion region that which contains in the CSF, okay? Removing and put the fat, get out, okay? This is the fat, remove this part, perfect. So I'm gonna touch base on the little bit acoustic neuromas where the anatomy is most important. I'm gonna show you two cases of the normal intact hearing and young patients, okay? Look at this. This is 44-year-old, this is 40-year-old. One is the intracanalicular little extension into the cistern. One is not much extension, but look at this CSF space, okay? Look at that. So if this is a perfect case for retrosigmoid approach, because we can preserve the hearing. We don't need to drill the canal too lateral. If we drill the canal too lateral, if this tumor was extending laterally, then you're gonna injure hearing. Okay. But this is a perfect case for retrosigmoid. So it's simple. And this is although bigger, might be a little difficult with the middle fossa. Look at that. Tumor is going all the way. There is no CSF space in the lateral canal. So this is a good case for the middle fossa approach. And hearing preservation. Cured and preserve the normal function, okay? Understood? And we have tumors like this too. Very reputable center, they remove this tumor, acoustic neuroma, and left this much tumor, okay? And they told her, this is not gonna grow. If you don't remove the intracanalicular portion of the tumor, even if you do subtotal resection, you are not cutting the blood supply in acoustic neuroma. So it's gonna grow. And it didn't only grow, it started giving these symptoms. She developed trigeminal neuralgia, very severe. So look at the trigeminal nerve root here, okay? And they put her on the medications, increased, she became sedated with those medications. Why can't we remove this, right? We can remove it. And she lost hearing after her first surgery, after retrosigmoid approach, residual tumor, growing tumor, and causing more problems now. Translabyrinthine approach, we neurosurgeons don't know much about it, but it gives you, if there's no hearing, perfect case for translab, okay? See the facial nerve, we're gonna amputate this super vestibular nerve, and we preserve all the functions, nerves going around. See, this is the facial nerve at the brainstem, sharp dissection, and removing the tumor piece by piece. And finally, you'll see how the trigeminal nerve was crushed by the tumor, okay? See, that's the facial nerve. Actually, clearing from the tumor from the facial nerve wasn't that difficult. The more difficulty when we approach to the trigeminal nerve is, you see trigeminal nerves, these are the sharp dissectors, is very, very compressed by the tumor, okay? So I'm gonna remove that part, and then you'll see the trigeminal nerve, how it is contused by the tumor, okay? So facial nerve is clean. You'll see the trigeminal nerve. See how much compression on the nerve and irritated the nerve. See motor branch, sensory branch, portia minor, portia major. We remove those, okay? So this is very stuck here, but we're gonna get it, okay? It's not that difficult. If we think it's difficult, in our mind, everything becomes difficult, okay? I'm not saying it's very simple, do this. I'm telling you, if you aim for these skills, you go to the lab, study, you develop these skills, okay? Nerve stimulating, okay? Perfect face, trigeminal neuralgia is gone, gross total resection, fat graft, cure. Okay. Same. Cystic large tumor. I'm gonna skip this. Cured. Okay. Petrochlamydial meningioma. Okay. Oh, many centers will go gamma knife debulking. Many surgeries. Gamma knife. Why? You can remove these tumors as long as you know how to do it, right? Anatomy. Combined transpetrosal approach. You combine with the middle fossa and the trans lab in this case, because she didn't have a good hearing. If she had good hearing, you can do retro lab, grade 2 facial weakness. But she's happy. She's walking now. She was having issues, headaches, and 2 years they sit on this. They call it inoperable. Same with the foramen magnum tumors. Okay, anatomy. Dissections in our lab. You need to know this anatomy, and if you know it, it becomes easy, okay? So dentate ligaments is significant compression on the brainstem and the upper cervical cord. So you cut these dentate ligaments, you make windows, and then you debulk the tumor and then devascularize. Basic principles of the meningioma surgery, same in skull base, okay? So we'll cut, we'll remove, and approach gets you to the tumor, and then applying the principles set by our pioneers, you do those, and everything becomes simple, okay? You don't make it the complex, you go for the simple thing. Okay. You see the contralateral hypoglossal nerve attachment, and the clivus detach, remove the tumor, piece of the dural tail, remove the tumor, okay? She was quadriparetic, she improved significantly right after surgery, histology grade 1. And sometimes you have these crazy cases, okay? This patient is radiation-induced grade 2 meningioma, had multiple 6 surgeries, all these crazy ciliary approaches and other things, just, and they call it minimally invasive. is maximally invasive because it's not safe and you are not achieving what you need to do. And six surgeries every time. And the tumor grows, complete ophthalmoplegia, complete blindness, and tumor is growing to other side. And he received like million times radiations, million experimental therapies. And what we did the bypass first. Okay, so we can remove this tumor and the ICA. Okay, this is the bypass from the common carotid to the M2. And then excentrate the orbital part and the cavernous sinus, and then put the fat here. Okay, this is fat graft. Okay. It's simple, right? Patient already lost the vision. There's no function in that eye. Why you keep doing the so-called minimally invasive surgeries? I'm going too much, so I don't want to go to the vascular cases. Maybe I stop here. Maybe some other time I can go over the vascular cases if you guys agree. Some other day. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to stop here. So I'm not going to tell you guys anything. And my conclusion is go to the lab, study the anatomy in the lab, study these practices in the cadavers, animals, simulation models, increase your tactile senses, and don't get stuck with that fancy terminology, minimally invasive this, minimally invasive that, I go through, I go here. No, safest approach is the safest approach in your hands, okay? Avoid brain retraction, brain relaxation by arachnoid dissection, maximal safe exposure. If you need to expose this much, expose this much. If you need to expose this much, expose that much, okay? Don't try to be a boutique neurosurgeon, okay? And you need to know the topographical anatomy, pathological anatomy, and how to get there, how to get out from that, okay? And go to the lab. That's the only way, okay? Go, read, listen, watch, dissect in the lab, and then go to operating room. I hear, I forget, I see, I remember, I do, I understand, okay? So I have another webinar in 20 minutes. I invite all of you guys. Dr. Sami Yusuf will be speaking about vestibular schwannoma surgeries, and I'll be hosting that. So, and I'm happy to do another session with you guys or multiple sessions. And thank you for your attendance. And I apologize for taking too much time. I'm happy to take any questions.
No problem, Dr. Mustafa Baskaya. First of all, thank you a lot for your great explanation and trying to explain as easy as possible the such a difficult cases in the neurosurgery, especially like neuro-oncology. Here I have a few questions for you. So question number one, if you already count with intraoperative MRI and fluorescence techniques, which other options can be useful to make better surgeries?
Better surgery starts with the good surgery, good surgeon, okay? These, like I said, intraop MRI doesn't do the surgery. You do surgery. We do surgery. Intraoperative MRI is a good adjunct, if you have it, to increase the extent of resection and then doing that safely, okay? Same with the 5-ALA. In my experience, fluorescein or 5-ALA in GBMs or any other gliomas doesn't help me at all. I don't use anymore. It's my impression under the microscope counts much better than the impression you gain by the dyes. Intraop MRI is very useful.
Yes,
ultrasound, if you have a good ultrasound, is very useful, but I don't have a good ultrasound. But luckily we have a 1.5 Tesla intraop MRI, and I use it not always. In the cases that I think is helpful, okay? So you are doing the surgery, not ultrasound, not 5-ALA, not intraop MRI, okay? Anatomy. First, you learn the anatomy.
So we have another question. Thank you for this one. It really makes sense. How do you decide which tumors are candidates to an awake surgery?
Tumors involving the motor cortex and the speech cortex, cortices or cortex I'd like to do awake craniotomy if patient also can tolerate awake craniotomy. In some patients who cannot tolerate awake craniotomy, you can do sleep motor mapping, phase reversal, and there are different techniques, but you cannot monitor the speech, of course. So only tumors that involve the motor cortex or the speech cortex, I will do awake craniotomy. Mm-hmm. Others, insular gliomas, thalamic, you cannot do anyway. And other cingulate tumors, limbic tumors, mesial temporal lobe tumors. I'm not cutting any brain tissue. I'm not doing anything to do those centers. So if you do good microsurgery, you don't need to monitor those functions with the awake craniotomy.
And here are a few more questions. For a supracerebellar approach, do you sacrifice veins?
You try not to sacrifice any vein if possible. So especially the tentorial bridging veins. And if you are coming paramedian, you can see one or two and try not to sacrifice any vein. There are ways of skeletonizing them, cutting the arachnoid around on the brain side and releasing the adhesions. So you can elongate them by when you apply the retraction, okay? And especially the major veins, never. Try never, okay?
Mm-hmm. Do you cover with anticonvulsivants any incidents of intraoperative convulsions? How you manage it?
Under general anesthesia, you don't worry about the seizures. Of course, you give prophylactic seizures when you do intrinsic glioma surgery. But for awake craniotomies, make sure patients start to have the anticonvulsants long days before the surgery. And during the surgery, another load. We used to give additional antiepileptic, but now that affects the motor mapping. We realize that we just use one if patient has only one.
Mm-hmm. And the last one, do you use navigation or sonography during surgery for thalamus tumor, transsurgical approach?
Do I use neuronavigation?
Navigation or sonography during surgery for thalamus tumors, transsurgical approach?
Yeah, I use neuronavigation. I use neuronavigation and for thalamic to any tumors, it speeds up the surgery, and you make your craniotomy smaller, and it makes you simple. So I use everything, but I don't 100% rely on them. I rely my own anatomy, and it's good to check. Sometimes I say, okay, maybe tumor is here. You put the thing and you check yourself. You really, and then if you just rely on one thing, then you stop thinking. You let the machines think on your behalf. So don't do that. Just always test, challenge yourself. Okay, I say the resonance, for example, I put this here. See, am I right? Maybe if I'm wrong, then I'm not doing right thing. I need to think better. Topographical anatomy. So use those to test yourself, challenge yourself, and enhance your knowledge, but not let them replace you and your knowledge.
Yeah, that's really reasonable advices. Like, you can rely on yourself when you are a neurosurgeon and you're standing in the operation room. I guess that's true. Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Mustafa Baskaya. I know you need to be in a hurry now because you will have a next webinar. We're really grateful that you agreed to took part in this Congress. Thank you very much for this. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you, Medical Students Chapter. And thank you, Mr. Jorge Herrera, for the great organization. And hope to see you soon.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, organizers, Andrea. And I'm, like I said, I'm happy to do more sessions if time allows. And thank you for having me. And please have a wonderful rest of the weekend. And stay safe and healthy, okay, in this challenging time.
Sure, you too. See you. Okay.